Random House Audio presents The Cat's Table. This is the author, Michael Ondaatje. For Quentin, Griffin, Kristen, and Esther. For Anthony, and for Constance. And this is how I see the East. I see it always from a small boat. Not a light, not a stir, not a sound. We conversed in low whispers, as if afraid to wake up the land. It is all in that moment when I opened my young eyes on it. I came upon it from a tussle with the sea. Joseph Conrad, Youth. He wasn't talking. He was looking from the window of the car all the way. Two adults in the front seat spoke quietly under their breath. He could have listened if he wanted to, but he didn't. For a while, at the section of the road where the river sometimes flooded, he could hear the spray of water at the wheels. They entered the fort, and the car slipped silently past the post office building and the clock tower. At this hour of the night, there was barely any traffic in Colombo. They drove out along Reclamation Road, past St. Anthony's Church, and after that he saw the last of the food stalls, each lit with a single bulb. Then they entered a vast open space that was the harbor, with only a string of lights in the distance along the pier. He got out and stood by the warmth of the car. He could hear the stray dogs that lived on the quays barking out of the darkness. Nearly everything around him was invisible, save for what could be seen under the spray of a few sulfur lanterns. Watersiders pulling a procession of baggage wagons. Some families huddled together. They were all beginning to walk towards the ship. He was 11 years old that night when, green as he could be about the world, he climbed aboard the first and only ship of his life. It felt as if a city had been added to the coast, better lit than any town or village. He went up the gangplank, watching only the path of his feet. Nothing ahead of him existed, and continued till he faced the dark harbor and the sea. There were outlines of other ships farther out, beginning to turn on lights. He stood alone, smelling everything, then came back through the noise and the crowd to the side that faced land, a yellow glow over the city. Already it felt there was a wall between him and what took place there. Stewards began handing out food and cordials. He ate several sandwiches, and after that he made his way down to his cabin, undressed, and slipped into the narrow bunk. He'd never slept under a blanket before, save once in Norelia. He was wide awake. The cabin was below the level of the waves, so there was no porthole. He found a switch beside the bed, and when he pressed it, his head and pillow were suddenly lit by a cone of light. He did not go back up on deck for a last look, or to wave at his relatives, who had brought him to the harbor. He could hear singing and imagine the slow and then eager parting of families taking place in the thrilling night air. I do not know even now why he chose the solitude. Had whoever brought him onto the Oronze already left? In films, people tear themselves away from one another weeping, and the ship separates from land, while the departed hold on to those disappearing faces until all distinction is lost. I try to imagine who the boy on the ship was. Perhaps a sense of self is not even there in his nervous stillness in the narrow bunk, in this green grasshopper or little cricket, as if he has been smuggled away accidentally, with no knowledge of the act, into the future. He woke up, hearing passengers running along the corridor, so he got back into his clothes and left the cabin. Something was happening. Drunken yells filled the night, shouted down by officials. In the middle of B deck, sailors were attempting to grab hold of the harbor pilot. Having guided the ship meticulously out of the harbor, there were many routes to be avoided because of submerged wrecks and an earlier breakwater. He had gone on to have too many drinks to celebrate his achievement. Now, apparently, he simply did not wish to leave. Not just yet. Perhaps another hour or two with the ship. But the Oronze was eager to depart on the stroke of midnight, and the pilot's tug waited at the waterline. The crew had been struggling to force him down the rope ladder. However, as there was a danger of him falling to his death, they were now capturing him fish-like in a net, and in this way they lowered him down safely. It seemed to be in no way an embarrassment to the man, but the episode clearly was to the officials of the Orient Line, who were on the bridge, furious in their white uniforms. The passengers cheered as a tug broke away. Then there was the sound of the two-stroke and the pilot's weary singing as the tug disappeared into the night. Departure. What had there been before such a ship in my life? A dugout canoe on a river journey? A launch in Trincomalee Harbor? There were always fishing boats on our horizon, but I could never have imagined the grandeur of this castle that was to cross the sea. The longest journeys I had made were car rides to Norelia and Horton Plains, or the train to Jaffna, which we boarded at 7 a.m. and disembarked from in the late afternoon. We made that journey with our egg sandwiches, some thalagulis, a pack of cards, and a small boy's own adventure. But now it had been arranged I would be traveling to England by ship, and that I would be making the journey alone. No mention was made that this might be an unusual experience or that it could be exciting or dangerous, so I did not approach it with any joy or fear. I was not forewarned that the ship would have 7 levels, hold more than 600 people, including a captain, 9 cooks, engineers, a veterinarian, and that it would contain a small jail and chlorinated pools that would actually sail with us over 2 oceans. The departure date was marked casually on the calendar by my aunt, who had notified the school that I would be leaving at the end of the term. The fact of my being at sea for 21 days was spoken of as having not much significance, so I was surprised my relatives were even bothering to accompany me to the harbor. I had assumed I would be taking a bus by myself and then change onto another at Borla Junction. There had been just one attempt to introduce me to the situation of the journey. A lady named Flavia Prinz, whose husband knew my uncle, turned out to be making the same journey and was invited to tea one afternoon to meet with me. She would be traveling in first class, but promised to keep an eye on me. I shook her hand carefully, as it was covered with rings and bangles, and she then turned away to continue the conversation I had interrupted. I spent most of the hour listening to a few uncles and counting how many of the trimmed sandwiches they ate. On my last day, I found an empty school examination booklet, a pencil sharpener, a traced map of the world, and put them into my small suitcase. I went outside and said goodbye to the generator and dug up the pieces of the radio I had once taken apart and, being unable to put them back together, had buried under the lawn. I said goodbye to Narayan and goodbye to Gunapala. As I got into the car, it was explained to me that after I'd crossed the Indian Ocean and the Arabian Sea and the Red Sea and gone through the Suez Canal into the Mediterranean, I would arrive one morning on a small pier in England, and my mother would meet me there. It was not the magic or the scale of the journey that was of concern to me, but that detail of how my mother could know when exactly I would arrive in that other country, and if she would be there. I heard a note being slipped under my door. It assigned me to table 76 for all my meals. The other bunk had not been slept in. I dressed and went out. I was not used to stairs and climbed them warily. In the dining room, there were 9 people at table 76, and that included 2 other boys roughly my age. "We seem to be at the cat's table," the woman called Miss Lasqueti said. "We're in the least privileged place." It was clear we were located far from the captain's table, which was at the opposite end of the dining room. One of the 2 boys at our table was named Ramadhin, and the other was called Cassius. The first was quiet, the other looked scornful, and we ignored one another, although I recognized Cassius. I'd gone to the same school where, even though he was a year older than I was, I knew much about him. He had been notorious and was even expelled for a term. I was sure it was going to take a long time before we spoke. But what was good about our table was that there seemed to be several interesting adults. We had a botanist and a tailor who owned a shop in candy. Most exciting of all, we had a pianist who cheerfully claimed to have hit the skids. This was Mr. Mazzappa. In the evening, he played with the ship's orchestra, and during the afternoons, he gave piano lessons. As a result, he had a discount on his passage. After that first meal, he entertained Ramadhin and Cassius.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.